Adar has given me this opportunity to interact with these young budding lawyers and provide them some knowledgeable nuances and introduction in the country. So basically, this field of law is a very specialized field, a very close field to my heart. As much as interesting as it sounds, it is a very interesting field and interesting branch of law. Now I want to know how many of you all know exactly about maritime law. Yes. Brief introduction as to what admiralty law or maritime law means. Does anyone know about this field of law? Active session here. So yes, Tejas, I'm thinking. Tejas, Mr. Tejas has said that he knows about it. Who was that? May I know who was this young lady?
Sir, I'm sure, but have no idea about that.
Okay. So yes, definitely, this field of law is a very niche field. Today there might be a lot of other learned colleagues who know about this field, and the field of law is very new to. I shall try and and get an overall picture of the admiralty functions of the field of law. I am sure all of you all present here find it very interesting. Also, to tell you about the branch of law, it is very important that you need to understand the developmental history behind the law. Does anyone have an understanding of a history of maritime of India? How the history of the maritime domain in the country developed? Anyone about? Does anyone know about the Indian maritime history? Specifically, anything, any knowledgeable nuances with regards to shipping or with regards to the maritime industry that since when India has been facing this. So actually, India has been a very well-known shipping and maritime historical nation. As we all know, we date back to 3rd millennium BC, where we found traces of maritime trade happening in between the Indus Valley civilization and ancient Mesopotamia. Also, if you all know about the Roman historian Strato, also has mentioned about the Indo-Roman trade, like importance to spices. So we've been a very historical maritime contingent. I'm very sure all of us, the great Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj, also had a very futuristic approach with creation of the Indian Maritime Navy, or the father of the Indian Navy, ensured that he had a small but capable naval force, which also for pretty much existed the Portuguese under the general Kanoji Angre, right? I'm sure you guys know about this. Coming to the point of very recently there has been something the 5th of this month was the National Maritime Day. Do we know about that? It's a belated National Maritime Day to all of you guys as Indians, and you should know that the importance of the National Maritime Day was basically the Steam Navigation Company manufactured the first Indian ship by the name of SS Loyalty. But that was the first ship that took Indian manufactured ship that left from Bombay port to the UK. And that is how important that day is. It's a very active role in the maritime, global maritime network is that started from 1919, I suppose. Yes. So these are certain small nuances that you all should know about. Coming back to our topic, talking to you about the branch of law till the, so is it okay if I talk about the development of the shipping industry and the shipping law with regard regards to development of maritime law happened up till the year 1993, where the Supreme Court has given a judgment, which happened in the year 1993, which is equal to Keshav Nand Bharti for constitution, is what MV Elizabeth is for the specifically to maritime law. Yes. So let's start. So a little trivia for you guys, as we start, the word maritimus, which is a Latin word, yeah, which indirectly comes from the word mare. Mare again means sea, something called as law of the sea. Yeah. Now we also talk about maritime law as admiralty law. So admiralty law is synonymous, and admiralty law comes from the word admiral. Now I'm sure everyone knows about what admiral is. Admiral is a person who leads the navy of nation, right? So yeah, maritime law is a very vast subject and considered and covers various subjects, say like collision at sea, proceeding marine insurance and salvage operations, several other topics as well. It's a very vast field. But what I intend to get into is the aspect of law, which is very procedural, which helps in filing proceedings in court for claims and arising out of ships and vessels traveling. One has to understand how the branch has come in existence, as it is very interesting. And you shall find a link in between the development of this field of law that happened and other fields as well. As we know, foundation of any legal system is based on the development of the field of law. To elaborate the statement, we know that almost 250 years back, or even more, we had slaves, which probably did not have a legal right. It was the law that gave. In our case, we are going to talk about ships and vessels. You shall see, till the 18th, by way of charter. So as English law is concerned, by the way of charter, used to give corporate existence and legal existence to these companies, and that has been given legal personality for it to act. Thus, the legal system extended the legal persons, but also giving juristic persons like companies, corporations. In our case, it's going to be ships and vessels. Ships have been, here ever since, 1,000 years of trading and, massively has been taken care of by, 80, almost 90% of the trading happens by waters. Is the seafarers on the ship, the crews, the vessels, the large-scale export-import that is happening through, which is coming back to our point. Ships incur liability. How your ships and vessels have a legal personality on their own? That means they incur liability. Contract in the sense picking up essential water, essential goods, bunkers. How many of carry a lot of export import, carry gross tonnage of products from one port to another? So obviously ships need repairs at ports, right? So hence ships started invert to take care of this problem. The law devised a system by which legal personality was confirmed on the personality. Hence, you could proceed against the vessel once you have incurred the vessel in case of any maritime dispute with regards to a fact that you do not really need to know the place of domicile or the place of residence of the ship owner. You can go against the vessel, because the vessel in itself is it? So, most importantly, with regards to certain claims which arose with respect, what are the disputes that come across when it comes to the shipping framework or the maritime law? Is, which are regards to the difference in between maritime claims and maritime liens, which framework and the shipping disputes. I shall get back to it. But for now, I'm going to talk about, law was. So basically, it has its networks come through, there was something like a century, we had something called as the Rhodian Sea Law, which was, which created that kind of, so you have law within that. You also have something like the ancient, you have AD, you also had the rules of Aurelon. Aurelon basically, ladies and gentlemen, was where basically the English law has deterred itself, specifically with regards to admiralty law. It's a very ancient law is what I want to say. We're talking about developed in King Henry's the first developed it with that time there was a post by the name of the Lord High Admiral. Yes, the Lord High Admiral, the man who was the Lord High Admiral used to look at all the administrative affairs and all the functionalities with regards to admiralty. To the vessels and ships at that time. Please remember that is very important considering talking about a long, long time ago. So there were spoils of war. There used to be war in between. There used to be ships coming on. And all of these admiralty functions were taken care of within the pertinence of a vessel and a ship by the Lord High Henry the First, yes. So that is one bit of it. Had something called as equity and common law courts, yes. So when they had equity and common law courts were kept different and separate from the common law courts, yes. What's as to who is going to function on this admiralty process? Who is going to look after the disputes that are cutting chain through the shipping? In the year, I'm not sure about how these disputes arisen. And, under the Admiralty Jurisdiction Act 1389, so, with regards to the Indian jurisdiction, we have the Admiralty Courts Act, 1861, which are considered prior to the 1993 case that we are just about to discuss. The 1861 Act of the Admiralty Courts Act. Basically, this was pre-independence. This was all English. With regards to maritime enunciation and maritime activity, with that, the genesis of admiralty law developed, perhaps shall be interesting to note that as ships were independent, this history with regards to admiralty law has been enlisted also very interestingly in the Ram Janmabhoomi case. Everyone knows about what happened at the Ram Janmabhoomi, yes, right?
Yes, sir.
So, do you all have any accrued understanding of where the shipping and maritime been any enunciation of admiralty law or history with regards to admiralty process that has been mentioned in Ram Janmabhoomi? at, I think it's reported 2020, volume 1, Supreme Court cases, page 1. If you go to, there are at least 11 which look after this process. The paragraphs from 117 to 127, you shall find admiralty law. Because, you know, why I'm saying this is just an example to show in between this field of law and other fields of law with regards to the system of law in place, right? Perspective of an admiralty lawyer. To an admiralty lawyer, guys, you know, and our budding lawyers, I'm very sure you'll know what it means to, what do you mean by an action in rem? For us, basically an action against a thing. This means the action you institute against a ship or a vessel interested to the vessel, or to say having a right considering the vessel. This has a lot of leeway of property. Hence, the adjudication is binding to this property. That is the vessel or ship that we are talking about. A person who has a claim and dealing with a vessel, the law imposes this to achieve a purpose of having an obligation. Any, are you all clear till now? Are you all understanding what an action in rem? You can always stop me,
sir. Can if you all want repeat to repeat it meeting. Once again?
Absolutely. When I'm talking about, as we know, is action against a thing, right? So when we are talking about it, to an admiralty, it does, is the this means that an action you institute against a ship or vessel is really binding. It really binds or has certain kind of rights with regards to the obligations that are maintainable towards the ship or the vessel.
Sir.
Because this has a lot of legal significance, guys. Right? Why is this done? Is to give an effective remedy. The 1840 Act, the 1861 Act, there was a very important act. The British had enacted the Colonial Act 1890. This is an again date. It's very important to understand these developments in law. Because I feel you shall understand the law better, right? Because maritime law has come down very in the sense that it is a very that we kept as a nation. So we have, it's very important that you guys know this. So when we are talking about the colonial, it conferred jurisdictional powers to colonial courts, and under the same there were 6 courts that had admiralty jurisdiction and powers, 1690. You know, they being the Court of Calcutta, the Court of Madras, the Court of Bombay, Rangoon, if you know, and Aden, which is now South Yemen, which is part of the English, British, and the District Court of Karachi. So basically, we have, you know, this kind of specific to these specific courts and these specific courts alone, right? You should know this. When we talk about India Act 1891, just a year later, there was something called as the Admiralty Court India Act, which made the courts of Calcutta, Bombay and Madras to administer admiralty law within the nation. So now, until the declaration, so now we know about 1890, something called as the Government of India Act 1915, which reiterated the same, that the courts of Calcutta with the different powers of admiralty jurisdiction in the country. Yes? So,
please pardon, sir.
Yes. Huh, absolutely. So 1890 may the Colonial Courts Act hua, six courts of law naming Madras, Kolkata, Bombay, Rangoon, which was a part of British India till 1937, and the District Court of Karachi. Post that, we're talking about the 1890, about the fact that the courts of Bombay, Madras, and Calcutta were given esteemed powers of admiralty jurisdiction. Again, in the Government of India Act, basically, which is, we're talking about very complicated for you guys. You can stop me. Huh? You can tell me that this is a little complicated for you all. But it is very important that you know that. You all should know about how the development of the Admiralty Law happened. And then, coming back to the point, the Government of India reiterated the same, that these courts shall have an effluent power of Admiralty jurisdiction. Now, until the declaration of Lord in the 1993 case of M.V. Elizabeth, which can be referred to as absolutely, according to me, it should be referred to was the Bible of the Admiralty in India. I will come back to that right now, but I'll just give you an interesting analogy of Admiralty Law. So now, the jurisdictional entailment of Court of Calcutta, Madras, and Bombay. There was a time when the delegated itself the power of Admiralty jurisdiction pan-India. Do you all know that? I mean, how can you do that? He will laugh. Like, does Bombay High Court have jurisdiction in a Gangtok? It won't be able to have that, right? But it's an interesting tidbit. So basically, for example, if a ship has to be arrested on the port of on the coast of Gujarat for say happened as a valid maritime claim, and the suit is being filed in Kolkata High Court, it was maintainable. Very interesting. Now you guys know that this is not prevalent practice. Just as an interesting point. Come to the M.V. Elizabeth case. This is a very important case, guys. Please note, every admiralty and maritime lawyer knows this case is one of the more pioneering ones. So I will give you all a brief statement of facts as to what happened in the M.V. Elizabeth. Right? In 1984, the plaintiff was Harwan Investments. It had trusted some goods in Marmagoa. Marmagoa, right, everyone? The vessel sailed away without giving bill of lading. How many, those people who know maritime law, those people who have read certain things, how many of them know a certain document by the name of bill of lading? So bill of lading is a document, is a terminology which is given by the carrier that on the receipt of goods on the ship. Right? Bill of lading is a very important document in the shipping terminology and the shipping contract world. All right. Please read on that. So, without giving that bill of lading...
It's basically the list of goods actually they are carrying.
Yeah, basically it is the list of goods and it is like a valid receipt from the carrier. Carrier thinking about the shipping, the ship or the person or the master of the ship basically is carrying the goods on top of the vessel from one port to another. Yeah. So it is a valid evidence of receipt of goods. Yes. That bill of lading was not given. That bill of lading was not given in this case. And the vessel went and delivered the cargo in UAE, United Arab Emirates. It gave and it came back to Vizag. I'm very sure you guys know all of these very important ports in India. There's a lot of amicable situations currently happening, very active sector. We are going to talk about that. It's very interesting. I want to have a word with you guys with regards to the same. But anyways, this vessel, it delivered cargo to the United Arab Emirates and came back to the port of Vizag, which is Vishakhapatnam. The owners of this cargo, which was Harwan Investments, filed an admiralty suit in the AP High Court for the arrest of the vessel. As it's known, practice that security is to be given for release of the vessel. And suit was tried and the suit succeeded. It is to be noted that until this case, it is seen that Andhra Pradesh High Court isn't conferred with admiralty jurisdiction. What had we spoken about prior? There are only three, only three high courts which are jurisdiction. How can AP High Court take that kind of a process? But the AP High Court, you know, the point that AP High Court took was the Admiralty Act of 1861. There was no jurisdiction in respect of outgoing cargo or outbound cargo. Outbound cargo, guys, means any kind of goods that are shipped outside the country. With respect to us, outbound cargo means, goods or cargoes going out of India. So here, there was no jurisdiction in respect of the outbound cargo. Outbound cargoes are basically cargoes going out of the country. The language of the 1861 Act was taken into consideration. Point was also that if AP High Court in itself had jurisdiction or not, it was decided by the Supreme Court later in 1993. The MV Elizabeth case citation is AIR 993, Supreme Court 10104. So 1014, for those who want to read the judgment. This is interesting as it was lawmaking and I guess a case of judicial activism so far as admiralty law was concerned. It was, I believe, Justice Thoman, who was the Honorable Judge who dealt with the matter. The crux of this case and the inference that is important is that an absence of Admiralty Act here in India. Please, ladies and gentlemen, remember the absence of an Admiralty Act here in India. The Indian Admiralty Courts are to administer English law that was prevailing. That is the Administration of Justices Act. With regards to the English law, Administration of Justice Act 1956, you have the 1981 Supreme Court's Act based on the Brussels Convention. So, apart from that, basically, in admiralty law, we have extensive provisions. Also, it's very important to know the Merchant Shipping Act of 1958, which also gives valid, it has valid sections 443 and 444, which provide for arrest and detention of a vessel. So the MSA is regulating shipping industry. It has safety of life and property. It also establishes National Shipping Board, registration of ships. There's another area which is very important in the field of maritime domain and should be considered important for those who are interested in the field, the Merchant Shipping Act. Yeah. I'm also going to talk about another case by the name of MVC Success that was happening in 2004. You shall see, after 10 years, the Supreme Court put exertion on the need and importance of having an Admiralty Act. Here the issue was that unpaid insurance premiums for ships are necessary or not, and hence, are they valid maritime claims? The Supreme Court spoke that there was a ship arrest of 1999, which falls under international law, and hence, it shall be accommodated. So this condition of whether these insurance premiums, everything, so basically Supreme Court averted that under the ship arrest convention, there are certain valid claims, and because this claim is a part of the 99 ship arrest convention, it shall be part of the Indian national system, right? The national law. Hence, it can be seen that there was an expansion of the scope of a much rather ambit of the admiralty process.
Excuse me.
Hence, really, by the example is we can see the development of maritime law, where we know now.
Excuse me, sir.
The development from.
Sir, can you please elaborate? Unpaid insurance.
Yes. So basically, I shall come down to that. So now, again, so just a brief. I can tell you, insurance premiums. So with regards to when we're talking about the shipping law or admiralty practice, we have or maritime practice, there are separate sets of laws that govern. It's a vast field in itself. You have the Merchant Shipping Act, you have Marine Insurance Act. So, I'm not coming down to the unpaid premium part of it, but, there is a lot of dispute or claims that arise out of insurances on the cargo of a ship. Yeah, because when we are talking about cargo, we are talking about a tonnage of amount of products that are traded from one place to another, right? So a person who is into the export and import business, he would definitely want to insure his products, right? If something happens at sea, if something happens at sea, if the vessel does not reach. So, you know, there are important terms like insurance that are supposed to be taken care of. There are P&I clubs which handle this process specifically for ship owners and shipping vessels who are insuring, you know, who are insuring their cargoes on the ship. The ship itself is also insured with regards to a lot of processes. You have the hull and machinery clause. You have the general average clause. This is all shipping contract and marine insurance. If you all want to know about marine insurance, you all should also have read up on the latest incident of what happened in the Suez Canal. If you guys can also tell me about anyone knowing about this really important recent incident that happened in the Suez Canal, guys. Who knows about the ship MV Ever Given? It was halted in the Suez Canal, which really created almost 10 to 12% of, you know, a global sanction. Basically, almost the Suez Canal, guys, is a global choke point is what we call it. There are almost 7 to 8 choke points in the Indian Ocean contingent, also, which connect, which are very important in the global trade market, as we say, and Suez Canal is one of them. So just because the Ever Given had halted traffic in Suez Canal, almost 10 to 12% of the global trade came down. Many of you all know that almost $9 billion have of market was affected. Why? And then in this case, why I'm saying this is because, you know, cargo on the ship has to reach from one port to another port in a given estimated period of time. If it doesn't reach that time, if you are a buyer sitting in Dubai and I'm a seller sitting in India, and we have a contract which says that, you know, it's a time charter party. Again, it's a very important, these terminologies are very important. Charter party agreements, charter party, time charter party, void charter party, you know, all of these things are very important as shipping contract terminologies. If I'm selling mangoes and these mangoes are not going to the United Arab within that stipulated amount of time, and the buyer has paid me as per ripe mangoes, they really need to process in that period of time alone. If they go after that, who is going to take care of it? The buyer is going to be like, you know, these mangoes are not ripe anymore. What am I to do? I have paid for something, and it's obviously wo ye ek peti to nahi le rahe na, ek dozen to nahi le rahe. Obviously, ship pe ja raha hai, so it's going to be gross tonnage amount. Exactly. So there's a lot of money inculcated in that. So this entire process is supposed to be insured. And that is where this insurance premium comes through. So insurance premium and unclaimed insurance premium. Who is going to look after these maritime claims? Then there are disputes with regards to this, with regards to who has to pay the insurance premium. The P&I clubs, usually what they do is, it is an inculcated loss where you're talking about big money, guys, big amount of investment when you are talking about export and import happening via ships and maritime trade in general. You know, so the P&I clubs sometimes delegate their claims to the ship owner. The ship owner says, this is not my fault. The ship owner delegates this to the fact that it was the responsibility of the port authority or the state authority or the closest coastal state authority. So it is a very big picture, and that kind of dispute arises usually during these insurance premium processes, right? So that case that I'm talking about, basically the Sea Success one, it had this. But the Supreme Court, that time, as we know, guys, that we did not have a process of a proper formulative admiralty code. So the Supreme Court spoke that the Ship Arrest Convention of 1999, which is an international convention, which falls under international law, shall be accommodated within the national law. Right? Now, as we're talking about insurance and everything, I'm going to come to something called as marine, you know, in the concept of maritime claim. And with the concept of maritime claim, we have something called as the maritime lien. The difference is of utmost importance. Maritime liens are very special sort of claims. There are certain cases sui generis which attach themselves to the vessel irrespective of its change of ownership. So if a vessel was sold and there was a transfer in ownership, then also the maritime lien, where specifically we can speak about, say, you know, maritime liens are seamen's wages, master disbursements, salvage operations. Such other specialized claims come under this ambit. they stick. Even if the ship is sold again, then there is a transfer of ownership. This particular kind of processes, if you're talking about seafarer wages, dispute with regard to seafarer wages, if I'm the owner of the ship and I'm selling the ship to, you know, to Manan, Mehta or say Tejas, you know, I'm selling that to you, transfer, you will also have to be obligated under, because I have not paid the seamen wages, that comes under maritime lien. Okay, so maritime lien does not get over even if there is a transfer of ownership. Now, under the new act, there are various processes that they have spoken about the fact that maritime lien post 1 year, you know, an exclusion of limitation of 1 year, and post 1 year that maritime lien can be, you know, resolved or doesn't need to go any further. So with regards to the same, you know, that is what maritime lien is. And maritime claims is in general, as we see, are damages done goods on board the vessel. These are certain statutory claims. Now, this was very well explained. Actually, write this down, guys. His Honor Justice Narayanan, in the Supreme Court judgment, in the case of Chrysomar Corporation versus MJR Steels. Yeah, Chrysomar Corporation versus MJR Steels. His Honor Justice Narayanan has spoken really nicely with regards to this. The citation reported is 2018 SEC 16 SEC 117. Yeah. Where here the Honorable Justice Narayanan reiterated that the 99 Arrest Convention is going to be a part of the Indian Admiralty Law, where he explained in great detail on the question of the difference of what maritime lien and maritime claim is. It's a very big topic in itself, yeah. So in order to cover that, I'll need more. I think I'll need another 10 more lectures with you guys. But you know, because of short amount of time, because I'm just trying to give you all these general concepts and general ideologies for those people who are interested in the admiralty practice to know. We are also going to talk about now, probably, I don't know whether, I think I spoke to Borade Madam, in the Jurisdiction Settlement of Maritime Claims Act to you guys, 2017. It's a new code.
No, sir.
Yes, sir. Do you...
Please refer to it, because I want to refer to it.
No.
Nahi kiya hai. Go about it. Okay, so I'll just give you all a brief understanding of this enactment. Basically, it's come up with the name of the act, guys, is the Admiralty Jurisdiction and Settlement of Maritime Claims Act. I'll repeat it again, the Maritime Claims Act 2017. Right? Those who have it, please open it. Those who don't, you know, please enlist this, and you know, you can find it anywhere online. So it's a PDF version. Everyone has it, I hope. Of this act is to consolidate the laws relating to admiralty jurisdiction, right? Legal vessel, the arrest, detention, sale, and other matters connected therewith and incidental there. It is trying to create an outstanding code for making sure it covers almost as much as possible, right? This is a very warm and welcoming change, because the Supreme Court was looking forward to this in 1993. The MVC success case ka bhi, you know. All of these, since NIPA has been referring to Admiralty Code, having an Admiralty Act. Yes, we definitely have different acts, but formulation of a code, which just came into place in 2017. So when we are talking about it, that is the preamble in 2E of the Admiralty Jurisdiction Settlement of Maritime Claims Act 2017, Section 2E. Which speaks about the High Court. I'm just reading this. High Court in relation to an admiralty proceeding means any of the High Court of Calcutta, High Court of Bombay, High Court of Gujarat, High Court of Orissa, High Court of Kerala, High Court of Judicature at Hyderabad for the state of Telangana, and the state of Andhra notified by the central government for this purpose. Now, guys, do you understand? Now, within this enactment, high courts of all coastal states have been given admiralty jurisdiction, right? Before, as we discussed, it was only three states, and it has been given powers of all high courts of all coastal states will be able to do admiralty process. This is also given in the section 3, where it is said, subject to the provisions of section 4 and 5, the jurisdiction in respect of all maritime claims under and be exercisable over waters up to and including the territorial waters. The territorial waters. Stop here, probably with the law. How many of y'all know about territory? Territorial waters, you know, something called as a limitation, or there are zones. There are particular zones when we are talking about the water. You know, the UNCLOS is very important. It's an international convention, and the Bible. It is the United Nations Convention on Law of the Sea, which is very important. Bifurcates all of the, you know, we have we have internal waters, we have territorial waters, we have exclusive economic zone in the water, we have a continental shelf, outer limits of continental shelf. Bifurcation happens, the sovereignty of consideration and the rights that are given to the national up till 12 nautical miles exerting to 24 nautical miles is the sovereignty of the of the national or the self, where they can create that national jurisdiction. So because of that, under the 12 nautical miles and 24 nautical mile mark, the national law is processed. Outside that also, this process, area beyond the continental shelf is no one's jurisdiction. No country owns it. It is for all. It's privileged for mankind, and you know, it any ex, ex any what do you say happening is for the common good and betterment for all the countries in the high seas, right? That is supposed to be read about. Section 4 of the Maritime Claim under the same Act, Chapter 2, Admiralty Jurisdiction. Here you are thinking about what is Sir talking about when it comes to maritime claims. So these are the maritime claims that are deterrently very important about disputes regarding the possession or ownership of a vessel or the ownership of any share therein. We are talking about descent or earnings of the vessel, mortgage or charge of the same nature or vessel, loss or damage vessel, and there are very various many more. I would get you all, so after section 4, section or maritime claim, and these claims are enlisted under section 9 of this enactment, brief enactment, which talks about claims for wages. We are the sums due to the masters, officers, and other members of the vessel, which complement in respect of their employment on the vessel, personal injury occurring whether on land or water in direct connection with the vessel. We are talking about claims for ports, and all the other statutory dues. So these are certain maritime liens. And finally, it's a small act, just 18, 17. The application in India of the following enactment about repealing the Admiralty Court Act 1840, the Admiralty Court Act 1861, we have Act 1890, the Colonial Courts of Admiralty, India Act 1891, all of these are repealed under this specific development of those acts. We spoke about those acts which have been so very important. And till date, now that the new enactment has come into play, is game. Are you all clear? You all want to ask me something? I'm just about finishing and I'm going to have a conversation. Your with regards to maritime law, or if what is it that you all want to have a word with? When we are going to think presently, you know, we are supposed to talk about this. Again, I'm not, again, I don't want to bombard. You should also matter in the case of Alto Uber matter. Please have a read about it. The current challenges that we have to probably, you know, insolvency, or with regards to a wider branch of law, which for a vessel has a question which goes into litigation or goes into insolvency. What fixed ship or vessel in question, how is it going to, you know, look at matter of insolvency? As we know, under the Companies Act, we know everyone about the Companies Act, that there are particular methods and manners in which the company to be distributed. Those people who know a brief bit about the insolvency laws also, there is a manner under Section 14 of the Insolvency Code. No litigation against such a company filing for insolvency shall prevail. Say Section 14 of Insolvency Act, we're talking about companies, you know, we're talking about formulation of distribution of company assets in regard towards the company. And there is a difference if you look at the Section 9 and Section 10 of the Admiralty Act. So which applicability of which law? With pertinence to, you know, insolvency filed by a shipping company, an arrest cannot mitigate security. What happens? So again, because it's a special act made applicable to the vessels, and with respect to these maritime claims on the vessels. Anyway, I would end with this, you know, thought and sincere hope. All my fellow colleagues in the legal domain do find this branch. Happy to answer your queries, if any such. You know, such a wonderful and patient lot of listeners y'all are. Also, I shared my email ID with a process that y'all are feeling that y'all want to have any kind of conversation with me with regards to not only Admiralty, Merchant Shipping Act, any kind of shipping domain, you know, you can always connect to me with my mail ID. Please take it from Prince, or probably I might just give it to y'all right now. My email ID is Varun Shaligram, V-A-R-U-N, Varun Shaligram31@gmail. Varun Shaligram31@gmail.com. Any kind of process you find it very interesting, this field, you can come down to me. We can have a conversation anytime. Yes, with permission, faculty. Yeah,
sir.
Tell me about, guys. So now, thank you. Moving on to questions. Now you guys can question. Now, if you want, I can tell you, now that I've given you a brief history about how things have worked in this domain, I can tell you all about, you know, the faculty was also wanting me to talk more about you know, the opportunities as a maritime lawyer. So basically, you get a conversation, I will not be able to understand what exactly am I looking for. So anyone interested in the field of maritime and shipping, research within that domain.
Sir, I have a question.
Yes. Who is this? Rest y'all better.
Yes, sir. I am Tirth Purani.
Yes. Okay.
Yeah.
Yes, Tirth. Please tell me.
Sir, the Egyptian restriction in that area is
I am having an issue, I think, with the internet connection. Please, can you, I can't hear you. Very unfortunate. Can you do something about it? Did anyone hear his question?
Yeah.
I heard it a little briefly, but if anyone heard his question, can you...
Yes, ask doubt.
Yes, please. Srinathi, please
sir,
tell me.
Sir, you told about the Andhra Pradesh case of Andhra Pradesh.
Yes.
So, which act was it? Actually, it is not in the admiral was that.
So, Srinathi, it is very important for you to understand that, you know, when the Admiralty Courts Act, the Admiralty Courts Act 1861. Okay. So what happened in that case was the AP High Court took, why did they do that? Because there was not prevalent practice or prevalent law that determined the application of that case. But the AP High Court took onto itself that 1861 talks about that. And also later the Supreme Court, under the 90s, that the Andhra Pradesh High Court inherited admiralty jurisdiction from Madras High Court. Okay. So Madras High Court had the thing and said the Andhra Pradesh High Court has inherited those admiralty powers from Madras High Court. And so this case stands as jurisdiction of that specific case. So it is a very important case. Yes.
So, sir, Andhra Pradesh court for the admiralty case.
Yes, absolutely. Now, if you look at the new enactment, that is where I spoke about, in the new Admiralty and Settlement Maritime Claims Act, if you see definition 2E, you have all high courts of coastal states, that is Andhra Pradesh, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Tamil, everyone which faces the water exclusive right. The high courts of that state have exclusive rights to practice into admiralty process. Right?
Okay.
No problem. Any other queries?
Sir, I have two questions. Yeah, sir, to practice as a maritime lawyer, do we have to do any specializations post LLB?
See, so when it comes to maritime law, what does a maritime lawyer do? A maritime lawyer is basically one who fights anything and everything which is happening on the waters or the laws that are related to a vessel and ship. Right? Shipping terminology is Swapnil. Swapnil, am I right? Am I saying it right?
Yeah, sir. Yeah, sir. Because I am into purchasing from last aware about the Incoterms.
Oh, so you are aware. Oh, wow. So you are aware of the Incoterms. So that is very nice. So then it will be easy for, it is very important as a maritime lawyer. So now that you're into purchase, marine insurance and shipping contract terminology might be very interesting. I feel definitely you should carry forward this. There are certain Indian, colleges, Indian universities, which look after the same maritime lawyer. It is very important that probably even if you have an experience on the Incoterms, you should look forward to gaining, because there is, under international trade law, we have the Admiralty Act, we have the Merchant Shipping Act that is there. So basically, it will be preferable. With regards to that, I am very much, with GNLU, GMU, Gujarat Maritime University does, the National University Delhi, which has that course, National Law Bhopal has it, even Symbiosis Law College has a small course about it, but I'm not sure whether they do. So yes, I feel you should look after it. You should take maritime law into specific, and if Incoterms is something, you know, it's very nice. You should go ahead. You should move ahead with it. Swapnil?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you so much for the insights. Someone yeah. more thing that dealing with this kind of...
No. So now basically, it is the high courts who have been given the admiralty jurisdiction. So it is no look after it. But the admiralty court is a process in Bombay. You have certain law firms there. There are a lot of, maritime field of law. There are not many people who really understand the competitive segment that maritime law has. Guys, we have to organizer of, underwater domain awareness program, which was actually done by, which was inaugurated, we had it in Goa University, Pune University. It is very important that we know that the Indian coast, the India in itself is a sense, it's all for you guys to do it. The youth of this country, the maritime domain is so important. What is happening now? You're looking at the current government stigma. You all look at the schemes that the government is coming up with. For example, Sagarmala, how many people project Sagar? Sagarmala is a massive port development initiative of the government. Now is where the government has started coming into force. Of understanding of what maritime in itself or the shipping domain or the maritime domain means. Countries like Norway, Sweden, Denmark, concept of blue economy. Do you guys know blue economy is an economy driven by waters? Yeah, it is going to take time for us, but you guys really need to know as young budding lawyers that there is a field of shipping law. There is a field called as maritime law. Any kind of law is not going to give you money unless and until you are exquisitely expert in it. For the next 4-5 years, you are not supposed to look at it. But please believe me, once you all are a part of it, you all are supposed to give advices to shipping companies, to P&I companies, shipping vendors, to disputes on ship. There is a lot. It's a vast, vast, vast field of law. If you all, the more interest you all take coming to you guys, I can definitely tell you the competitiveness within this domain is very less. As of now, if you all take it as an advantage, as a business, as a lawyer, not many people are in this domain. Basic awareness is very important, and there is a lot of work, absolutely a lot of work in this domain. With regards to shipping companies, you can go, you can advise the government on this, you can advise the who have this this knowledge, with regards to port authority issues. The port authority government has a lot of issues. I have also personally been a part of the environmental impact assessment of the inland waterway schemes that the government is starting. I have also been a part of deep seabed mining prospects in Shanghai. I was invited by the Chinese organization, an aspirate legal research on deep seabed mining. So the more you go in this field, the more interesting it gets, guys. And I'm really grateful to Modern Law College and your esteemed faculty to call me, because it is so important. And who is very old in this domain, I also want to create that kind of an awareness to you young budding lawyers that take up shipping about it and think about it. It's a very beautiful domain.
Yeah, sir. Yeah. Thank you so much for the details. So I'll get in touch with you through college. Thank you, sir.
Absolutely. My mail ID is right there. Swapnil, is this who? Who is this Swapnil only?
Yeah, Swapnil.
Okay. So you guys can definitely tell me how things are working on that end. And thank you for being such a patient, listener, guys. I think this is at least some, not many, but some venting doors to your mind with regards to. Yes, who is this?
Mansi, sir.
Okay, yes, Mansi. Please
sir, me. Can we do internship in any of these law firms?
Absolutely. why can't you all do internships? Currently, you know, there are a lot of processes the way you can do it in Bombay. There are these law firms. You can also basically, before you get into an internship process, understand the industry and the industry domain, the shipping industry and the shipping industry domain in specific. So what I did was I started being, I was a research associate with a lot of research institutions, just in order to understand the basic shipping terminology of how the shipping industry works.
Then actually, we don't have a specific subject regarding mandate.
Does the modern law college give you all any kind of an internship bias with regards to this? Any kind of a placement committee that you guys have? If not, I will be definitely wanting to have a conversation, ma'am. I shall have an entailment with regards to, I shall take her time. And I shall have a conversation with regards to an internship process. If it's possible, we'll have a conversation about this and, you know, probably come down onto the internship statuses of things. If y'all are interested to understand the merit of the principal matter. Yeah?
Yes, sir. That will be great.
Absolutely. So, we can have kind of an internship process. Also, you know, there are other various maritime universities who do short-term courses as well. You know, please look at maritime, the upcoming field, basically all the litigation and the disputes that arise and onto this track usually go to arbitration because there's a lot of investment within this because it's not a small intensive and financially intensive and inclusive space. So, arbitration is a very important causation and a very important method that is used usually for dispute settlement. So, look at MCIA, look at Mumbai International Center for Arbitration, look at something called as Lloyd's of London, which is which gives the he's done Incoterms and you know he's into this. So you know Lloyd's is a very important institution. We have the SIC, which is the Singapore International Arbitration Council. These are all arbitrary institutions which do a great land scaling job into the shipping area. Shipping, please have a look at it. As budding lawyers, I would say y'all start noticing and interning at least as research associates. I would really personally, with regards to this, if she can entail you guys to do internships, I would be more than happy to take you all as interns with regards to research association and give you all more knowledge on this domain, and then you all can look forward to go to Bombay or go anywhere and everywhere to you know say Bruce Chambers, take on the legal processes of things just in order to understand. So now there are a lot of law firms, there are very senior people who work in this domain. I will help you all out if you all are very interested in this domain. I will talk. Yes. Thank you, Mansi.
Yes, sir.
Am I audible? Yes, we formulate some plan. I can definitely have a word with your faculty members. Yes?
Yes.
Anyone else? Thank you very much, guys, for being such a patient thought. And please, you know, I hope I have helped you all in venting some new doors and new avenue and new branch of law that is shipping and maritime law. And as much as I talk about it, the shipping industry and the maritime legal domain waits for you guys. Also know that this is a very leveraged domain one. So any kind of knowledge inculcation from my end will always be possible for you. You guys, and thank you, Modern Law, for giving me this opportunity to have a conversation with your such bright students that you all entail. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for the valuable lecture.
Sir, could you please put down your email ID in the chat section?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I will do that. Yes. There you go. Thank you. There you go. Have you guys got it?
Yes, sir.
You can text me, mail me anytime. I'm always there for you guys. Need in the shipping domain is always coming through in the rightest ways and the rightest.
Thank you, sir.
Very ethically.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you so much, Advocate Varun Shah.
Thank you.
I hope you all enjoyed it.
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Yes, sir. So now I request Assistant Professor.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, guys. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
I take this opportunity to deliver a vote of thanks for today's case, which has been conducted by Advocate Varun
Shah.
I thank Dr. Gajanan Ekbote, sir, chairman, Business Council, PE Society, for encouraging us for organizing. Also thank Advocate Dr. Chintamani Ghate, sir, coordinator, PS Modern Law College, and Dr. Sunita Adhav, ma'am, the college, for their continuous support and guidance. And I express my heartfelt gratitude towards Advocate Varun Shaligram, sir, who is practitioner in maritime law.
Thank you, sir.
For sparing his time with us and from his busy schedule and guiding us on the topic, that is career opportunities in maritime law. So, sir, guided on the history and development of maritime law, various enactments in this particular field, that is shipping industry, wagera. Sir, also discuss and explain various landmark cases on this particular topic. So, sir, I extend my vote of thanks to you for sparing your time with us. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Wonderful morning.
Yes.
Have a wonderful day. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.